Chris Stellion here for Hobby Game Dev. Thanks for tuning in today. We'll be talking about using PHP and PHP MyAdmin and MySQL to do some really basic database manipulations. This is pretty introductory stuff as these technologies go. As my tutorials often do, I'm sort of barely skimming the surface of complexity for what these are capable of, but I'm trying to get you from a situation where you've got maybe no background with it or just little familiarity to a point where you're then ready to, anytime you find other online tutorials or example code, you can kind of wrap your mind around it more easily, integrate it into a foundation you're able to lay through what we're going to cover today. The things we'll be covering specifically are beginning with setting up your PHP website space online and a PHP MyAdmin MySQL setup. That's unfortunately going to be kind of open-ended because I don't want to railroad you into my particular service of choice. The second part will be showing how to use PHP MyAdmin to manually fill in values on a database and manipulate and browse those entries. The third part will be using a form in PHP to input values into the database. And then the final part will be looking at how to use a PHP file to organize and list and output that information from the database, covering what you need to be set up, how to get something in place in the database so we can manipulate it, then how to manipulate the database and how to expose values from it. At the end part, we'll be covering some really basic SQL query commands that we'll use through the PHP to select, access, and update values in that database. I always like to try to address why we're learning something as opposed to just running into it. PHP is useful for generating dynamic web pages. It's effectively a programming language that generates HTML. HTML, of course, being language for most of how the web works. MySQL is the database flavor of choice for a lot of situations. It scales well, and it deals with large amounts of information very efficiently. If you need to sort through different types of user accounts, through different types of user-generated content they've submitted, through various other types of data your game may want to reference that's changeable, sort of it's the internet age equivalent of data files. So for starters, unlike previous tutorials I've given, you will, for this one, need some sort of space online already. We can't really start from scratch so easily. Unless you've got the option, you could locally install a PHP and SQL database setup. That's a little more advanced than what I'm covering here. That's something you might do if you're on a full-scale development team. You need to be able to test and iterate locally. For a lot of what we actually wind up doing at a lower scale, especially for prototyping, is you'll just be working directly on an FTP space for an outside server. So if you don't have a server yet, so first of all, if you're with a university, you probably actually do have web space. It's worth looking into. They probably already support SQL, PHP, and have a PHP MySQL installation. If not, you should check with your IT services about that. If you're not in university, there are numerous services out there that are offering to provide you with these facilities in terms of a server, PHP, MySQL, MyPHP, MyAdmin setup for around $5 a month. In some cases, maybe even a little less. In some cases, you can pay more, get a little more. I use startlogic.com. I don't necessarily mean to drive business their way, but I will say that it has met my needs. There are many other options out there for you to compare and contrast, but as a baseline, for about $5 a month or about the cost of one video game a year, I'm getting about as much bandwidth as I need, and it meets my needs in terms of PHP, MyAdmin, SQL, and so on. So once you've got that set up, then we need to access PHP MyAdmin, which for start logic is a little bit roundabout. I'll just quickly show you what I do for that. First of all, we have to log in through custom system. And then here we have an option for databases. Right there, we can create new database. We give it the username, password, and name of the database. Note that this password is separate from, in my case, my start logic account. And in a lot of cases, no matter what service you're using, your general server login information may be different from your database password and so on. So you want to jot that down. So we have it here in a minute when we set up our page. So in having created the database, now I can click on it and choose to view it in PHP MyAdmin. And this is where this is no longer start logic specific. This is now pretty much what you'll see no matter how you're getting to it. And if you're going through school services for this, you'll likely have a special URL to go to access your PHP MyAdmin. No matter who your provider is, poke around. You can probably find their way of getting to your database in this fashion. Now, once we're inside the database, we need to be able to hand populate it just with some sample data while we get started, as well as this is also a good way to structure the information so we have something for our PHP to interact with. For starters, let's go to create a new table. And when we're creating a table, it wants to know how many fields there are. Fields are sort of the equivalent in database land of variables to a class in local programming. So this is how many values do you want to keep track of for something. So as our first table, let's create a table of bad guys or bad guy info. Let's name it that. So let's see, what might we want to keep track of? Let's keep track of the name of the bad guy. Let's keep track of how many maximum hit points he has. Keep track of how much gold it's worth. We could actually, let's say min gold and max gold, so we can have a range of how much gold we want to return for the person. Let's actually leave it at that, because there's going to be other things we want to specify, like attacks or loot drops or something. But I'll show you in a second how we're going to use linking tables to set up a many-to-many relationship for that to work. So that was only four variables I mentioned. That was min gold, maximum hit points, and name. There's actually a fifth variable we're going to add. So for every single database table you ever make, you're going to have one extra field in there that's an integer to keep track of just a number for each entry. These numbers are semi-arbitrary. They tend to increment, so we'll begin at 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. And what this is important to have this auto-incrementing ID for is that when you are connecting up database entries to other ones, so if we have like a user on Facebook and his photographs or her photographs, you don't want to connect that information through the user's name in case they have to submit a name change, say they get married or something, and then you have to reconnect all those connections between the data. So instead, we want to have a number for the user, and that's the similar number you actually see and sometimes in your URL as you're sort of browsing Facebook. That number is connected to the information in a way that's abstracted from the contents of that entry. So all said and done, we're going to have 5 fields for this bad guy info section. Now, this may look intimidating because there's going to be a lot of these boxes to fill in. The trick is we can ignore most of them, right? There's only a few that really affect us. We care about the variable type, and we care about the name of the field. The variable type, there are really only a few of those we need to look at for our purposes. If you're working on large-scale databases professionally, there's some real important subtle nuances between these different types. For our purposes, we're pretty much looking, as we often do as programmers, for integers, for float values or the equivalent, and for strings, which have slightly different names here, but you'll see those as we fill those in. So first of all, fill in bad guy ID, capital IND, and this will give us an easy convention to stick to for how we number things. This way, if another database entry needs to reference this one, it can refer to it by its bad guy ID. We want to set that type to an integer. And instead of filling it in, we're going to have this one auto increment primary key. So you'll check here for this option, as you can see I'm doing on the screen. Right, so we're done with that one. Now the next one, we want to name this, let's say bad guy name. And we'll set the type to varchar instead of text. Text allows sort of arbitrary length and is not very efficient, but it's useful if you had like long articles in a database that you don't know exactly how large they're going to be. If you have some idea of an upper bound, so let's say we know we're going to never have a bad guy's name over 50 characters long, then we can set it to varchar and we set here the size to 50. And then we also wanted to say how many hit points does the bad guy have. Let's specify this one with decimal precision so you'll note what I'm selecting there. And then we'll also select min gold and max gold. We'll set those as integers. Okay, so we've got these values filled in and we click save, and now we have that structure there, but we don't have anything filling in that structure yet, right? So there's no bad guys we're keeping track of information for, and so you'll see up here if I mouse over it, we can't actually click browse yet because there's no bad guy data to browse. So what we have to do for that is we have to go to insert tab, and now here under insert, you'll see it gives us fields for putting in 2 of them. We could ignore one, let's ignore one the first time, and just type in some values for this. So we can leave blank that auto incrementing enemy ID, it's just gonna fill that in based on whatever the next one is available. And we're gonna put in for the name, let's say thief. Maximum hit points 100, gold, min gold, max gold, let's say 60 to 80, just as some numbers. We'll submit, and you'll see now when we go to browse, now you can see we have our thief data in the database. Keep in mind that at least as we're dealing with it here, this is kind of an enemy description. This isn't a specific enemy, so we don't have hit points on them and so on, but you very well could use a database in that fashion, as Facebook does, to have one real instance per entry. It really just depends on what level of abstraction you want to use. So as it's currently set up, we would be checking the database to find out the stats for this enemy, but not to keep track of the enemy's state. Up to you as to what level of abstraction you choose to use in making databases. So let's go and insert a couple more entries just for illustration. Let's go and make an orc, and let's make, I don't know, space marine, just to kind of mix and match. Give him some health value, give him some minimax gold. Again, leave those auto increment fields blank. We'll press go. All right, so now we have 3 bad guy types in our database. Something I didn't show yet though, because these fields, these are the right way to fill in information about things like where you know there's a one-to-one relationship between this enemy has 1 piece of information about its health maximum. This enemy has 1 fact about its min gold and its max gold. If we want to have something where there's a many-to-many relationship, so if we think about what types of loot does the enemy drop, if you think about that, any given enemy might be able to drop different types of loot, and any type of loot might be able to be dropped by multiple types of enemies. So for that type of relationship, we're going to look at doing a linking table, and that's something that's slightly more advanced, and it's going to clarify why I named these variables things like bad guy name the way that I did in Camel Case. So let's create a new table, first of all, for loot. So for that, we're going to go back to our top-level database view, and we're going to create a new table, and let's name that one loot info, as we did with bad guy info. Now, what info do we want about loot? Let's kind of keep it simple for now. Let's just say loot ID. And again, it's going to be an auto increment primary key integer. We're going to say loot name, like so. And we could have item info somewhere else if we wanted to store it differently in the database. But for now, let's just go ahead and say like value. So we have something about the value of the drop. Press save. Once again, we have a description now for what it means to be loot, but we don't have any entries because if you mouse over browse, you'll see that we can't go in there yet. So you have to go to insert, and then over here in insert now, we can fill in a couple of values for loot. Let's go ahead and make a small sack of gold. Leave those auto increment fields alone. They'll get filled in for us. Small sack of gold, let's say, is worth 50 coins. Huge sack of gold, let's make it, I don't know, 500 coins. Let's go and insert some more entries too. because, you know, these don't take very long. And now for these, let's say fire potion. I don't even know what that is. But let's say it's worth 1,000 coins. And for another one, I don't know, chainmail armor. And let's say that's worth 800 coins. And now notice, you know, we could, press down there. We can add a new field now. If we wanted to change how we store about each piece of information. So if we go back to our structure for our section, and we can add a new field on the end. Let's say probability, right? Or so chance of being dropped. And there's a ton of ways we could deal with this. We could deal with this on the enemy side. We could deal with this differently per enemy. But for now, to keep things simple, let's set it per type of loot. And so if an enemy can drop a certain type of loot, it'll be dropped with this amount of probability. That'll get complicated for us, so we're going to ignore probability of drop for now. But we could add at the end of the field, if we wanted to, additional values and then fill those in by editing the entries. I do want to point also the structure of what's going on with the screen when we're in the browse view, for example, is that each of these in the individual rows corresponds to that entry. If we want to edit it, we can use this button here with a pencil. If we want to delete it, we can use this button here with the X. You can also put a check mark along the left side, and then along the bottom you have your master commands that allow you to edit multiple at once, delete multiple at once, and so on. Okay, so we have these values for loot, we have these values for enemies. There's currently no connection between them. We're going to create a third table. So go back to the database level, add new table. This is going to be a linking table. And now a linking table is where we line up those integer IDs we've been using for like field ID, for bag ID. This is how we can line them up together if we want a relationship between them. And so this one is only going to have 3 field values. We're going to call this one loot bad guy link table. Now give it 3 fields. Each of those is going to be an integer. One is going to be the link ID, auto increment is fine for that. So for link table, we're going to keep that primary key as its own sort of auto incrementing field, just as a good exercise. These other two we're going to have as the loot ID and as the bad guy ID. Okay, we create that. We go to browse, and once again, we can't yet because there's no values in there. If we go to insert now, what we're going to do is we're going to take the bad guy ID and the loot ID for any that we want to create a relationship between, right? So let's open up a new tab, so that you can kind of control click or command click depending on your OS of choice. These other two tables and browse through their values. And this is sort of a clumsy way to do it by hand instead of by using a PHP form, but it'll illustrate the point. If we want to connect, if we want the thief to be able to drop the chainmail armor, then we'll look at the thief ID number over here. We look at the chainmail armor ID over here. We put those both in there as a new field entry, as new entries for those fields for this type of database entry in the link table. And let's do another one. Let's say that the space marine can drop the fire potion or a huge sack of money. Space marine can drop a huge sack of money. So we put that integer and that integer over here. We press go, fills in 2 values. Let's go and insert a couple more. And you can see down here, we can change if we want to add even more. But let's say the space marine can also drop chainmail. For sake of illustration, we'll fill in, as you see me doing, those same integers. And then let's say, what other bad guy we have? We have an orc. Let's say the orc can drop small bag of money. Let's do a couple more. The orc can drop a big bag of money. Orc can drop chainmail. There we go. So we've got some examples now of different bad guys connected to different types of drops. All we see here in the database are these numbers, but again, what's beautiful about this setup is that if we go back into these other entries now and we change the name of the orc, so it's like Mega Orc, so if we decide that our game shouldn't have a space marine for consistency, we can change the name here and our connection between the loot and the data for this character isn't lost. Likewise, we can change information about the loot, its value, its name, etc., and it'll retain the connection between which types of enemies are connected to which types of loot. So this is as much as we're currently doing in PHP MySQL, we're now going to shift to doing things directly in PHP. Now, PHP, unlike HTML, typically won't run locally unless you're running a local server. So the way we're actually going to do this is to use your web space to upload files via FTP and then edit those and then be constantly sort of refreshing them on a web browser to view our changes. First of all, let's just create a blank document, type some words in it, Okay, name it .php, copy that into a folder you can view from a URL, and then let's refresh that page, or let's go to that URL in your browser, and you should see there those words. Now, if you type something in PHP, it'll just show up there. But beyond that, we can actually start formatting it just like we would HTML. Let's throw in a strong tag, we can throw in an ahref, an anchor tag for a link. We can put in we need BRBRs, break lines, to separate lines of text. And we, you know, just like HTML, this literally is HTML syntax. We can and should really start with HTML, go to /HTML. All this other business is recognized as valid PHP because PHP includes all of HTML. And now when I refresh this page, you'll see over here, there's what we typed. And now the way I've got that set up, by the way, is my FTP client of choice, and this is pretty typical for an FTP client, allows me to directly open the text file in a text editor, make changes and save them. And when it detects a change to the local file, automatically re-uploads those changes to the server. So if you save changes to your file you're editing in FTP and don't see the changes immediately, you may need to instead download the file, edit the file, re-upload it to see your changes take place. But hopefully your FTP client has this set up as this, again, pretty conventional, be able to make changes and just save and refresh the page. Okay, there's no actual PHP going on though yet. This is still just HTML. Now let's throw in there some PHP tags. These are a special tag, just like a lot of HTML is between the less than and greater than signs. Although here we're gonna use question mark PHP PHP down to question mark greater than, or less than question mark PHP down to the other thing. And so anything inside here is PHP code. So this is where you can actually have for loops, if conditionals, functions, classes, variables, all the sorts of things you're used to seeing in programming, we can do here. And if we say echo, and then use quotes and a semicolon, and we fill inside here, here is some text, save it, refresh the page, and if it all went right, you should see here's some text injected onto the page as though it were HTML. And in fact, if you do a view source on this page, you won't even see the PHP code, you'll only see the echo. So the way that PHP relates to HTML is that it's generating the code through these echo statements, and then we can have driving those different echo statements, for loops, if conditionals, database queries, API calls, to dynamically decide based on time of day, or based on time of month, or based on who's accessing the page, which information gets displayed. So let's first throw a quick for loop into the PHP just to show that we can use code and what it kind of looks like in PHP. You'll see here we have dollar signs for our variables. We don't actually have to declare variables in PHP as we do in other languages, which is a little bit dangerous because be wary of the fact that if you misspell a variable name in PHP, you won't get an error from it. It will just think you've invented a new variable right there. So you got to keep an extra eye out for that. Also, as a warning for writing code in PHP, there is no compiler feedback. You will not get reasonable errors even if you turn on all the error code feedback and so on. It'll oftentimes just show you a blank page if it's broken. So be prepared for some hair pulling while you're debugging, which is going to involve a lot of commenting things out. Speaking of which, PHP comments you can do just like you do in C or C++. You can do // and then some words just like you do in processing. You can do */ down to ** to fill in spaces in the middle, and that'll allow you to comment your code or to comment out code if you're testing something to try to figure out where the problem is. Why is your page going blank? So we've got a for statement. This will print it out, and you see if I stick that $i in this statement, then we can actually show over here each of those lines being generated. And once again, if we do view source, we don't actually see the PHP, we just see the generated code. This difference here of the fact we only see the generated code also allows us to do things like we can have our PHP password directly in the PHP file customers or clients or players access. It's invisible to them because they can't see the functions we wrote. They can only see the echo that we output. It all actually runs on the server and never gets transmitted down to the visitor's machine. Okay, let's create a form using some basic HTML, a couple of input fields. If you've seen this before in HTML but didn't know PHP, you might have wondered how to make these work, and that's what PHP is for. We're actually going to delete here the PHP section for now. We're going to have a separate file in a second. So we got a form. And here I have to put the PHP file of which file we want to transmit this information to when it receives it. And so let's send it to one called receive.php, which we'll create in a moment. And when we refresh the page, if we didn't make any typos, we should see these couple of forms with our labels on them right in front of them like so. And what we're asking for here is we want the enemy's name. We want the enemy's maximum hit points. We're under the minimum and maximum amount of enemy gold. And we also, we're going to soon add check marks here to allow you to add different types of enemy loot to connect to this enemy, but we're not going to do that just yet. You'll see in a moment how we're doing that. This is a post type, and so we're going to go to back to our FTP client. We're going to duplicate our initial PHP file, rename it to receive.php, open it for editing. Inside here, we're going to need to catch those post arguments, and the way we do that is this kind of funky notation of $_post, and here we put in quotes the name of it, as always a semicolon at the end. And I like to make these equal to local variables first thing, so I can avoid this sort of nasty post array access notation all over the place. You technically don't have to. You could just keep these _postings everywhere. It drives me bonkers, so I like to set them aside into local variables like this. Okay, so we got these values. And now on this receive page, first of all, just to prove to ourselves what it is that we're doing, let's try saying echo bad guy name, okay? Then let's provide a link, an ahref. Remember, we don't have to do the echo statement for this. We can do this outside the PHP. We can just say straight up anchor hypertext reference, and let's go back to index.php. If you're not familiar with why you're using index.php as the main file's name, that's the file that's assumed by a browser if you don't specify the file name for a folder. So this is kind of like the correct name, universally almost, for the default page in a folder. Okay, so now if we go back to our form, we should be able to type in bad guy name Dorito, and we put in some words over here, sort of some placeholder values. We press submit, we should see on this next web page the word Dorito, what we put in for our bad guy. And that's showing us that this information got passed from that form to this other PHP file, which in a moment we'll be able to integrate into an SQL call to save that as a new bad guy in our database, right? So let's go back to that page, back to the first page. Let's take another look at our receive PHP files code. And now in here, we're going to add a SQL insert call. And this will sound kind of funky if I say it out loud, so I'm just going to show you here the query DB call we're going to do. Actually, speaking of which, let's go ahead and make a new third file, if we can borrow this tangent for a second. And you may just want to download this from my page. I encourage you to type it, but if you find yourself making typos, it's going to be important to just download mine, perhaps. Now, query DB is this really straightforward thing I modified off somebody else's random code off the web. It's basically just a way to submit a query to the database and have it catch the error codes if something goes wrong. Because there's a lighter weight way to do database queries in PHP, where you basically just sort of of connect to the database, send a query, and hope it works. Fortunately, if anything goes wrong with that, if your password's wrong, if the database stuff is wrong, if it can't access it, if you're offline, whatever the case is, you won't actually get the error feedback. So I like to use this as sort of my go-to reusable chunk of code for PHP. You'll of course need to change here your username and your password. Those of course are not my real username and password for my database, don't be kidding me. But you'll need to customize those. Otherwise, this will all sort of work for you as is. And remember that because this is wrapped in PHP, it will not be visible to the outside world. It'll only be visible to you, but allow you to call this function. And now in order to call this function from this other file, we're gonna do an include in PHP, which is sort of a, I had a TA who called it a poor man's modularity, in that we can write this function in one place and then reference it in multiple files. But if you need a second to copy that, you can. You may as well just pause the video. No sense in me stopping here for 4 minutes while you copy that code. Or again, you can copy it off my website at Hobby Game Dev, where this PHP SQL tutorial entry is. You've got that now in your file, and that should also be up on your server, querydb.php, in the same folders, index.php and receive.php. Now back to receive.php, we're gonna do that include of querydb, and now we can do what I was going to say, which is this insert call. And so we're gonna do a querydb, we're gonna tell it to insert into which table, which values. And this, what's going inside these quotes here is SQL notation. This is separate language from PHP. This is, in fact, if you paid close attention while we're using PHP MyAdmin, every time we did any operation over there for browsing, for inserting, for updating, for deleting, it actually shows you which PHP calls are being used. So that's one way to learn SQL. Otherwise, there are a ton of resources out there on the web documenting different ways to use insert, select, update, and so on for databases. Some of which are pretty rudimentary and common, some of which are extremely esoteric and complex, but we're just gonna cover some basic ones today. You know, kind of take my word for it, like this is what PHP and SQL look like when they interact. So we've got this SQL call that's going to insert these values. And now pay attention to the order of these. So we put in no value for the auto incrementing ID because we want that to be trusted to the database. These other ones are filling in. And this is in the same order. If we go back to the browse, the PHP in our browser for our bad guys, this is the same order that those variables are being requested in, is the order that we're passing them in to this insert call with SQL. Okay, so we save that and we go back, type in some values here. Let's put in Warmec. Let's give it some values for these different numbers. And now we press submit. You will see there no feedback yet because we didn't give any feedback. But if we press return and we go back to the MySQL browser, we will refresh this page. And if all went well, you should now see Warmec listed in your database, right? Which this is kind of cool, right? This is a way that someone could, in the olden days, list things in your guest book. It's the way that still people post things on your wall. It's using a form to input and update and save information permanently online in a way that's accessible from other pages. What we're gonna show you next is how to access this information from another page. By the way, if you're having any errors at all, you'll see a blank PHP page. Best I can tell you is to try commenting things out until you see it working again to make kind of get your head on straight. But it's, like I say, debugging this stuff is a bit of a pain because you don't get the break lines like you do the local builds. So you know what? Let's not do this as a separate page for listing. I changed my mind. Let's do this right in index.php. Let's do a listing of the page. So let's include over here, querydb. Don't forget to include this since if we're gonna call it, we can't just expect the program to know to look for it. So over here, we've included querydb. We're gonna do, we're gonna save the value of the querydb into this other thing. Let's say enemy results equals querydb. Now we're gonna use a select call. And select is how you tell the database, I want certain information about certain entries based on certain criteria. And so you could specify like all Facebook users who have joined since December 2008, or you could say all users or all bad guys who are worth at least 500 gold and also have a name that starts with a B. Like there's all these ways we can specify what it is we want from the database and it'll give it back to us in an insanely optimized, very efficient manner. And so with here, we're just gonna say we want all the information we can get about the bad guy's info. We just kind of want all of them. We're not being too picky right now. Okay, and now we have to do something with that. We're gonna do this while loop that's going to get one entry at a time out of that set of results. So that set of results isn't yet usable. That's actually just a collection of information because there's two things we could call on that. We could call rows on it and find out how many entries are in it if all we want is a bad count of how many bad guys there are. In fact, let's start by doing that. Let's say echo, okay, we'll throw in this rows call on those results, comment that out, and let's put at the start of this how many bad guys there are, colon. And notice here I use the period. Periods are how you concatenate strings in PHP, not plus signs. Plus signs will mess you up and give you like the number zero as a result. That period is how you add together strings in PHP. Unlike before where I could just stick that dollar sign I in that for loop, here we need to concatenate these with a period because this is a function call and not itself a variable name. And so PHP would be less able to pick this out of a random string of text and know what we meant by the dollar sign in front of something. Of course, if you want a dollar sign, there's ways to escape code that. Okay, when we refresh the page, it'll say that we have this many bad guys, and you can double check in your database, is that how many bad guys we think we have? And it sure better be. Okay, so now let's change that from a rows call. Then let's go back to what we were doing here with this while loop where we're sort of fetching the entries one at a time. And now let's print out some information about them. You know, we could do this all kinds of pretty ways, but we're just gonna use commas for now and be lazy about it. We could format this really beautifully and be like, actually, let's say strong tags around the enemy's name. And then we can say, you know, the range of gold will express with a dash between it. Hit points, HP colon, and that's probably sufficient. We don't actually need to list the enemy's ID number, of course. While we're at it, let's be a little fancy and go up here and order by the bad guy name. So this will alphabetize the names that it gives back to us. Just as an example of one of the many ways you could sort. We could sort them by value of how much they're worth and so on. Well, let's sort them. Let's alphabetize them. Now when we refresh the page, we will see, thanks to our break lines, sort of spreading things out, here's our monsters that we currently have in the database. So we can now we can test and try to see, let's add a new one. Let's add Bill Gates and give him some values and stuff. Press submit, go back to the page. There's classier ways to do this than what we're doing here, but the point's hopefully getting across. And here you see, now we have a new entry in our database, and we don't even have to check in PHP MyAdmin because we're showing it to ourselves here in a pretty handy way. Now though, we want to use that linking table to say what kinds of loot are available to what types of bad guys. So what we can do for that is, so there's two ways we could go about this. We could, within each bad guy, do a MySQL select and find out of these two tables. So we have the enemy's ID, because that's the entry that we're currently on. We can do a search for all the entries in the loot table with that ID, and then we could do a search for all of the corresponding loot information for those IDs, but we can actually do a join call that'll do these together, where we do multiple sort of searches at once. Let me show you the example code for that. And this is effectively combining that table's information so that when we search for it by monster ID, we're getting back these sort of paired results. And it seems a little crazy, but I'll show you in a second kind of what's going on here. So there's their information together, so we can see which information is available in terms of the loot for each bad guy. If we want to be able to choose which information we want to add per bad guy, then let's add some radio buttons. And not a radio button, because we want multiple types of it per bad guy. Let's add checkboxes to this page. And we're going to use a select call on the loot database to get the names of each kind of loot to list here as options. Let's sort our loot by value, by how much it's worth. Go ahead and add a little bit of code for that. We can even put in parentheses that loot's information so we can make choices about it. We're doing like so. And this is just more information we put into the form data using HTML tags. And now when we refresh this page, you should see there a listing of all the loops we have. And of course, we needed to hook up over here in the receive to use that additional field data that we're getting from those checkboxes based on those values to create those link entries, which you'll just have to kind of watch here as I show you how to do that. Once again, I could verbalize this. Kind of silly though to read this sort of code out loud. You can see it visually on the screen. And as is often the case, you know, you can download again all the source from hobbygamedev.com under this PHP MySQL example. Now we can refresh it once again. Okay, there we go. So now let's add a new type of bad guy. Let's say a goblin, and let's give him a couple types of loot, values. When we go back, you should there see the information. And of course, that received page can and should be giving us feedback on if there's an error or something. So we could, for example, try to add another goblin top of an entry that already exists. Goblins is filling some gibberish, gobbledygook. And yeah, there we go. So now if we need to do instead is do a check. This is where in the received call, we can check and see if that entry already exists. Let's do that. It's a good exercise. Let's go to receive.php. First of all, we're going to select and see, does one exist by this name? And if it does, then we're not going to allow it. Then we're going to update the information for that one instead. The updating information is a pretty straightforward call to update for the fields. It's going to be a little more indirect for the link table because you're going to have to kill the previous entries and then maybe recreate the ones that have been checked. So there you have it. We've got database, which we can view and modify in PHP MyAdmin. We've got a form that can manipulate it as well as display the contents of it. We've got some PHP that's doing that for us. Of course, you know, sky's the limit. There's a million ways you could go with this. Databases are extremely heavy duty, complicated subject to become an expert in. I am, like I say, barely scratching the surface here, just trying to get you sort of your feet wet so you're ready when the chance comes up. Let's find some other tutorials or examples. You're kind of grounded in how to get started. There's probably some database experts out there wincing at that's some things I suggested here today. Maybe even some PHP experts wincing at things I suggested today. I'm just trying to get you into it. If you've got questions, I can try to answer them. As always, feel free to let me know at hobbygamedev.com or send me an email, hobbygamedev@gmail.com or chris@dalionic. Either one gets to me. And thanks for checking it out. Hope this has been helpful. PHP is useful for all kinds of stuff. You can also use it to access APIs, call outside functionality if you want to get information from someone's Twitter feed, if you want information from someone's Facebook account. There's all kinds of powerful things you can do with PHP to link it not just to your game, but to link it to the outside world and then maybe use that to mediate the outside world in your game. As mentioned, the previous entry about why learning PHP, this is also useful as a mediation between SQL calls in your game. So theoretically, you can do calls directly to SQL databases from inside your ActionScript 3 Swift or from inside your C++ program. You really should never ever do that. The reason is that it's really easier for someone to pick apart that network interaction and identify there and manipulate those database calls to break user-generated content, to cheat through submitting false scores and so on. It's far better to instead have information go through a PHP file that acts as a gatekeeper that can do some sort of checksum or timestamp or other sort of indication of identifying is this information legit, and then using that to screen and field those interactions between the database and your program. So that's another use of PHP, which we didn't really cover today, but now that you have an idea of how SQL kind of works and how PHP can interact with it, hopefully you're a little better set up to get to the next level with this stuff. Another thing to look into, kind of on your time because we're running out of time today, is get arguments in PHP. We dealt with post coming from the form. You can instead set things to get, and you'll see that they show up in the URL instead of being invisible. This is handy if you need someone to be able to save as a bookmark or directly link into a particular set of calls or information, say to certain search values or so on. We use get parameters for that, but kind of out of time for the day. Thanks for checking it out. Good luck with it. Hope that you continue to explore what you can do with these web technologies. As I've been saying, they're really not that hard compared to some of the low-level OpenGL graphics kind of stuff you guys typically deal with anyway for your video game work. Chris Deleon for Hobby Game Dev, signing out. Thanks.